We're gonna move on now to our keynote speaker for this evening. The company that we've invited down are engaged in an extremely important line of activity, which is to, their goal is to eliminate loneliness. And the first of their products that they've developed to do this is called AV1, and it was brought to the market from the point that it was conceived in just 10 months. And the mission of an AV1 robot is to help children who are, through no fault of their own, isolated socially from other children. So they're unable to attend school and they're unable to go and play with their friends. And this robot has been developed to enable those interactions to continue to happen. They're now working on another project, which is for tackling the same issues with seniors. So it gives me great pleasure to invite up to the stage now. Let me just clean up the screen first. It gives me great pleasure to invite up to the stage now Marius, Aabel from No Isolation.
One 3D printed prototype, and it's one of the actual product. And the reason is we filmed this last August, and last August, in the middle of the month, the final product wasn't ready yet. Still, we started using it in the school start of August 2016. Now I'm going to tell the story about how this company started and how the robot came to life. Everything started June of last summer, or 2 years ago actually. We got to know that children with getting long-term illness, they're isolated in the hospital. It was a friend of Karen, who is one of the founders. A friend of her is a nurse, and she told us that she sees time over and time again that when a child comes to the hospital with long-term illness, they get visitors the first week, and maybe the second week, but after that, nobody comes. They're all by themselves, only the closest family drop by. And if you're 10 years old and you're away from school for 6 months, that's a really long time. A lot of things happen during the duration of time. So we started looking into research. what we know about this problem. And we found research all the way back to the 80s, proving the problem that children are lonely when they get a long-term illness, and that it is really dangerous for them, because the brain is a continuous development during that period, and if you're away for 6 months, that's serious. 20% of the children that get illness that keep them away from school for 6 months, they never get a job, not because of the illness they had, but because of the loneliness. And we also found that loneliness is a huge problem in society in general. It's not only children with long-term illness, but we had a start. We also found that for grown-ups, loneliness is more dangerous than smoking 15 cigarettes a day. So it's, you're more likely to die of loneliness than smoking. So the situation, the summer of 2015, we had a proven problem and we had no good solution. And we really wanted to do something with this. So we spent the summer sketching up ideas. We had one idea in the beginning, we thought it was really good. We wanted to make a special tablet for children, with included family and friends. And luckily, we didn't just make the first idea we had. We tested it on Next of Kin. We found groups on Facebook. For most diseases, you have a group on Facebook for parents, where they talk about the problems that children have. And we made a questionnaire, and we asked the parents, what do you think about this idea? And the first thing we learned was that, thank you, somebody wants to do something with this problem. Finally, we also found out that maybe the solution you have, we had now is not the perfect one. So we continued to iterate. And the third idea we had was to put a robot on the child's desk in the classroom. So when they are away, they can be in the classroom through the robot. So the child can have a tablet or a mobile phone, and they can control the robot. They can speak, and the robot will speak for them. And they can see, and they can listen to everything happening in the classroom, like an avatar. And when we pitched that idea to the parents, they said, yes, this is what we want. We want it now. Can you make it for us? So that was the signal we needed. We ended our current jobs and had to wait 3 months resignation period, and it's a long time when you have a good idea. But finally, in October 2015, we were able to start. And what I'm showing here is the plan we made. You know, when you're starting a company, you have to make a plan. A lot of companies make like a 40-page business plan, and we made this. It said that in October, we're going to start. In December, we're going to have a working prototype. In February, we're going to start testing it on real users. And in August, for school start, we want to have a project. Kind of ambitious, but we didn't have any money, so the way to do it for us was to just do it fast. So, me and Matthias, who's sitting here, started writing code, 3D print parts, and trying to make this product. And Karen, she was just out telling everybody about our idea and telling everybody what we wanted to achieve and trying to get us some money. So, in November, we had this. It's a rough sketch of what the robot would end up look like. It had some electronics and could move, but not much more than that. This is later in November. Finally, we could control the robot from a phone. You could just use the finger and move it around, and the robot would move around. But if you see up here, all the electronics are still outside. So the next step now was to get the electronics inside the robot. So we started making some printed circuit boards, some electronic circuitry. And I worked on hardware electronics back in the 90s. So if you look at this board, it looks very like it was made in the 90s. And of course, that wouldn't do it for a long time. So we, with that electronics, we made a working prototype. But if you shook it really hard, it would break. But it was working. We could stream video, we could stream audio. and it could move. So during the month, we improved electronics, moved on to the 2000s, a little bit more modern. And in January, we had a working unit that was good enough to start testing. So I just can see the 3D printers we have. We bought 5 3D printers to be able to make enough units. And we sat on an office, 14 square meters, working 24 hours a day almost. In February, we start testing it in schools. So we made a pilot. We call it pilot 5x5 because we had 5 months from February to June, and each month we handed out 5 robots to children with some kind of long-term illness. And for each month we got feedback, we improved the electronics, we improved the software, and we did that 5 times. And this is from April. We had almost like a series production done. Looks very professional. But then after 5 rounds, June came. The school was over, and in 3 months, we were supposed to have a production-ready unit for sale. And we had only a rough prototype. So we hired a design bureau, a design studio, and they are really professional in making plastic parts. So they got the prototype from us, and we refined it, made it better. And in the end of July, we started cutting tools for injection molding. You know, we can 3D print if it's a low volume, but you can't make hundreds of units. We also had to learn a lot of new electronics. The prototype was made with Raspberry Pi inside and some custom electronics very close to Arduino. Now we had to make proper electronics, which can run Android, which was the operating system inside the robot. We worked on the electronics 24 hours a day almost for 3 weeks. We also had to buy a pick and place machine. It was too small, this electronics, to be able to build by hand. And in August, we got all the parts working together. We also got a larger office, and on the picture here we have the Norwegian Minister of Health visiting us. And in the end of August, early September, we had the first units, sold units, in schools. We then, from August and until December, we improved electronics still, and we produced the units inside our own office. We thought it was nice to do it inside, to learn about production, to make the device optimal for production. So before going to mass production, test it inside our own office and see how we should do it. And in parallel to this development, Karen was running and selling us. So we managed to get 7.5 million Norwegian kroners, that's around 700,000 euros in convertible notes. And at the end of the year, last year, we had a seed round, won 18 million Norwegian kroners, that's 1.6 million euros. We also have expanded a lot. In March 2015, we were 3 employees, and in June 2016, we were 3 employees, and June 2017, we are 41 employees. When we got to January last year, or this year, it was the demand was too high. We couldn't produce them ourselves anymore. So we needed to look for a manufacturing partner to make them. So we went to 7 other Norwegian electronic manufacturing partners and asked them for a price to make this and how we could do it. And we also had a requirement. This was early January, and we said we want units to roll out of the assembly line mid-February. So we have 4 weeks from we get the contract until we want units rolling out. And that's not an easy task. But luckily, we found one partner. I was able to do it. During 4 weeks, they managed to make all electronics, get all the other parts in, and start producing robots. So from this period, we learned a lot. We learned that doing prototypes is very, very different from doing production. When you're making 25 robots in-house, or you're making 1,000 robots, it's a totally different game. Just the components. If you want components for 20 robots, you can buy them on Funnel or Gearhouser. If you want components for 1,000 robots, you have a lead time of 10 weeks, 14 weeks, 20 weeks from your order part until you get it. We also learned that injection molding takes a lot of time to make the tools. It's a 2-3 months period just for the machines working and making these CNC tools. We were lucky we found a partner in China that promised us they could make it in 20 days. They just worked 24 hours a day for 20 days, and that equals up to 3 months of normal work. And IV1, we have sold 700 units approximately now. We're expanding to new countries, but now it's time for us to solve the isolation problem for new groups. And we know that the elderly, they have a lot of isolation problems. A lot of elderly people are lonely. We also found that it's a lot of different problems. If you used to be very active and you're immobilized, that's one problem. If you have modern electronics and modern devices that helps people and you're not able to use them, that's another problem. So from all these different problems we found, we had to choose one, make one product that helps one group. And we chose to work with people that are not able to use existing solutions. And we estimate in Norway, it's around 20,000 people, above 80, that are not able to use the solutions we already have, like a tablet or a phone. To find this, we had two researchers working full-time for 2-3 months, just examining everything of data we have already. And from that stage, we included the whole company, everybody that worked with us in January. We took a trip to San Francisco just to get out of the office, and we held a design sprint. So this is from March 2017. We had 19 people going over to San Francisco, going through the design sprint. So just this, we were just talking about different ideas. We made a lot of different possible solutions, like this one. It's an AI solution. And we selected three solutions to work with further. And this is one called a window, where you have just a unit looking like a window. You have curtains, and if you want to communicate, you just open the curtains, and the streaming will start. Very easy to use. We made prototypes in paper. This is another. The Phoenix is a radio with a screen. Maybe that should be called a TV. But we made all those prototypes in paper, and we took them to a senior center in San Francisco and tested them on the real people. Just the way we did, let's say we did with AV1, we wanted to have feedback from the actual users. So we asked them, we just told them what this paper thing is and asked them to do what they felt to do. And here you can see Ramya is demonstrating the radio, and we just, when the user did something, we just changed the paper in the screen. From those three prototypes we had there, we selected one, and that is a product for, which I told you about, it's about for senior citizens above 80, which cannot use the existing solutions. And we have been working on the prototype now for 3 weeks, and we actually started testing with the first user this evening while we're sitting here. They are back in Norway testing it for the first time. So, no isolation right now. We started a little bit more than two and a half years ago, three people. We're now 40 people. We have sold more than 500, almost 700 AV1s. We have 41 employees today, and we are developing our second product. We have also started our first office abroad in Amsterdam. We have five people working full-time there. We are now working on opening the office in London, and at the same time, so we are expanding in region and we are expanding in products. What we're going to do now is to continue doing this. We're going to launch new products for new groups, the groups that cannot use the generic product already available. We're going to staff up the Amsterdam office, we're going to staff up in the next office, and we're going to make a lot of new products. But to do this, we are now doing another round of fundraising. So this fall, we're going to do a Series A. We could choose to just go slow now. We have two products, we have selling, sales organization running. We want to continue expanding. We want to build a huge organization. We're going to make a lot of products. We're going to cover first Europe and then North America and Asia. So that's the story of how we have spent our last 18 months. And as a bonus, I'm now going to give the secret recipe. If you want to do a startup, if you want to make a business, you have to identify a problem, a well-known problem, that is not commercially solved yet. And then you have to make ideas on how can we solve this problem. And don't take your first idea and just go make it, test it. Ask the people that are going to use it, or the next of kin to the people that are going to use it. Is this a solution you would buy? Is this a solution you want? And when you have an accept on your idea, then you can make a prototype, and as soon as possible, take that prototype out and test it on real users. Because when we made AV1, the first prototype, we showed it to everybody we knew. And they had a lot of ideas. Somebody said, you need arms, so you can raise your arms and do like this. And they said, a lot of ideas, a lot of things. They said, you need this, you need this. Somebody said, you need a huge system, so you can integrate it into the teacher's program. But those ideas you get from other grown-ups, they are not the things you need in your product. We got a request from the first user of AV1, the AV1 prototype. I want it in black, and I want a Darth Vader voice filter. Nobody had told us that. They also told us that sometimes I'm too sick to be a part of the class. I just want to sit and look and hear and listen to what's happening. So what we made then, we made a light on the top, and if it's blue, it means that the student just want to listen in, and if it's white, then they want to be included. So test the prototype on real users, and then just run a lot of iterations on that. And at the same time, when you develop the prototype, talk to everybody about your idea. Tell everybody. That's the way to get funding, and that's the way to raise demand for your product. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.